Good morning. Good morning. All right, I think I'm on. Well, if you're at home, you can see, you know, we never know who to anticipate being here from week to week with everything going on, but we are here, we're full, and you at home are a natural part of our family extended into the online community. We're glad you're here. Could everybody just take a point and wave? We'll get the camera on you waving at people at home. Griffin's, yeah, look up front and wave right there. All right. We are grateful for all of our faith family, and we are grateful to continue to get through these improvements to our faith-based home. You see, the floors have been replaced. They're not quite finished. I wrote an article thanking Paul and Jesse. They have put in a lot of extra hours. That doesn't come with your training in seminary. It just comes with the curse that Paul's background is carpentry. So we are grateful. Could we just take a round of applause for their extra work? Next week is our dedication of our sanctuary. It is stunning. It's bright, light. The sound is phenomenal. I think our new accompanist is very happy with the new sound. It's bright, loud. Our choir is going to love it. So thank you for your generosity. This is not possible without your faith-based giving. We did this all without going into debt. Thank you for your generosity. We're glad you're here. We turn our thoughts to a new message series, 1, 2, 3 John, because there are 1st, 2nd, and 3rd New Testament letters from John. We're going to read at home one letter a week. And before you get all gerfuffled, that's a very short read. One letter a week, those letters are very short, so you can do this. The series is called Love is a Verb, and we look at that together today as we begin this new series together. Let's worship God. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Let's continue our worship by standing and singing the introit together.
Friends, please join me this morning in the call to worship. We gather to worship in Christian love and fellowship.
It is good to be together as children of God.
We gather to worship in the light of God's truth. Be glorified by our worship, Lord. Each of us, as hard as we strive, as hard as we work to be the best Christians we can, each of us falls short. Each of us stumbles, each of us sins. This is a time in our worship that we can go before God, confessing our sins, first silently, and then together. Let us pray. And now together, Lord, we have passed out of death into life because of your mercy, grace, and love for us. Yet we struggle to love each other in ways that glorify you. We squabble over small things when there are people who need to see the blessing of belonging to your church. Forgive us and renew a right spirit within us, that the light in us might shine forth in all we do. Amen. The good news of the gospel is this. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Beginning is now and ever shall be.
Hope that came through for you at home. Beautiful sound. And again, I want to thank Griffin and Paul for working on the sound so that not only can we hear it here, but people at home can hear it. Could we take a moment just to thank our technicians? Very difficult. When you're constantly plugging and unplugging and moving things around, it's hard to do every week. So they have to come in early, and without complaint, they invariably get us set up. So thank you. This is normally when we excuse children to go to their time. They can now. We don't have a lot of kids here, but we do have a program set up for them, and we're going to stand and take the opportunity to greet one another while they go to their time for children. We stand and greet one another.
Dear friends, I am not writing you a new command, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message you have heard, yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and in you, because the darkness is passing, and the true light is already shining. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is still in the darkness. Anyone who loves their brother and sister lives in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble. But anyone who hates a brother or sister is in the darkness, walks around in the darkness. They do not know where they are going, because the darkness has blinded them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So imagine if you will, you're in the woods, you're a grown up, and you're lost. and it dawns on you that you're lost. Now, this is a true story. My friend told me the story when I started enjoying outdoor life, mainly just being in the outdoors of Texas is where I first enjoyed being outside. And my friend owns land, and he was telling me this story that he knew better than to go outside without a light in the evening. But he got stuck in the woods, and he got disoriented. And you just don't realize how easy it is to do if there's thick brush, because you lose all your land markers. So he taught me about putting little ribbons up, like little ribbons along the trail, so you can just follow from one ribbon to the next, and you can take them down sometime. They don't hurt the environment. But he was out there, and he tells me the story. He was out there, and he knew he should have a headlamp, but he wasn't wearing his headlamp, so he could walk, you know, without stumbling. And he didn't have that. It's getting increasingly dark, and he realizes he's lost. And he is stumbling over roots and branches, and he falls several times to the ground to the point where he's got scratches on him, and he's starting to panic. And this is, and then he remembers he's got a backup light in his pocket, and he takes the light out, and he's able, but it took him an extra 2 hours to find his way out, and then he sat in his car and laughed with relief that he hadn't come to serious harm. Well, true story, that's about me. I did that. And actually the way I got out was I used my phone. My phone had a signal where I was in the woods, and I didn't know this feature. I had no clue this would work, but I pulled up my map orientation, and it showed where my car was parked. I didn't know that it was there. And then the little indicator, and you can indicate you're walking. It will illuminate the direction. So if you turn the phone this way, you know you got to go that way. So I just made my way back. True, but it took me an hour and a half to remember that I had a phone in my pocket. And a half hour to walk out. And I've told you, I feel good, but I don't feel great. I had an illness last year. I'm still recovering from it. And it causes me to shuffle my feet if I'm not careful. And I have to wear these soft-soled shoes because I have drop foot. So my foot clumps. And my balance isn't good. If I lock my legs together, I'll kind of rock a little bit. Again, I feel good, but I don't feel great. And it's exacerbated when I get sweaty. So I'm out there. I'm hot. I'm sweaty. I'm nervous. And I'm literally starting to feel my feet tingle, like the onset of it's getting bad. And I'm true candor. I am scared because when I checked my phone the first time, I had no signal. So there is no Paul to call and say, hey, man, I know you're an hour away, but can you come get me? Sorry. And how would he even find me? So this idea of having light in darkness is really carnal. Most of us understand it. A lot of you, would you just by show of hands, how many of you grew up with a night light or some source of light that you could follow in your child just for comfort? My kids still have that. It's disoriented to be in the dark. Even though it helps you sleep, if you got to get up and walk around, and I have to have one now, because if I can't see where my feet are, you know, I'll stumble and trip. Light and darkness is something we understand. And this title, Walk Without Stumbling, is an idea that we can all understand. When it's light, we have a clear path, we can see where we're going, and clearly it's related to the imagery that we read in this New Testament letter. So let's ask Holy Spirit to illuminate a new way of thinking about finding a path that God illuminates for us by looking at what was going on when this was written and what's going on with us today. Holy Spirit, come and illuminate us to the truth, that we would walk in the light of truth that has been eternally proven to be true. Before time began, you said, these truths exist. You are the great I am, the source of love. You are the one who gives commandments we are to follow. We are the ones who struggle and stumble over the truth. So may we be illuminated through you, Holy Spirit, in our hearts and minds, and may we learn to follow Jesus in ways that faithfully guide us on the path that you have set for us. In Jesus' name, in dependence upon Holy Spirit for illumination, and all of God's people said, amen. Amen. This letter's written. We don't know exactly what the controversy is, but again, this series, 1, 2, 3 John, for 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, not the Gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, probably not the same author. It's thought these letters were written about 100 years after the birth of Jesus, so sometime later after the Gospel of John, which was probably written about 90 years after the birth of Jesus, probably a different person writing in the same vein, but alluding to something that was happening at the beginning of the movement. There was some eternal truths that they were claiming about Jesus that clearly have been muddled in these years. Now, you and I, we know this. We live in a communication era that's completely different than anything in history that's ever existed. We're living in a 500-year paradigm shift of information. You can Google something and find it. You can find a lot of false information. That's emerging as a new problem, right? People post something and pretend that it's true, quoting Abraham Lincoln, the internet is great, right? You get it? He couldn't have said that. So there's just weird things. But in general, much less printed material, we have access to books and libraries. We have online access to truth. They didn't have it. So as they're emerging in this movement of Jesus' followers, things get twisted. A new leader emerges with new revelations about God. And this is refuting what those things were. We can infer that one thing that was coming up is people were starting to say, Jesus is not who you say he is. He was not a human being with divine components. They were mixing the two. This letter is saying, in part, get back to the basics of who that was. Now, I've pulled out a snippet, though, this morning that is very common sense, but has its own challenges to it. So just looking back at what we just read, knowing that the background is, really the letter is about refuting false teachings about Jesus, but here's a little common sense snippet right in the middle of it. Hear it again. I'm not writing you something new, I'm writing you something old that's been around, but in a new way I'm writing it. I'm writing you this, that the truth is seen in Jesus and in you because the darkness is passing. So here's the little common sense thing. Here, see if there's anyone that would dare stand up and say, well, that's not right. Anyone who claims to be in the light, meaning illuminated by God's love, knows the truth, following Jesus, whatever you want to claim is in the light, we'd all have different versions, but it'd be the same thing, right? We're in this room. In general, we're all looking towards Jesus, all trying to be God followers. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
This is the part. Anyone who claims that, but hates a brother or sister is still in the darkness. Right? Common sense. Can't be walking around hating somebody if you claim to have the light of God's love in you. Still here, Sam? Still here. And yet, it is the most difficult aspect of living together in Christian community. How do we work through wrongs? How do we do that? I don't do political sermons, not for fear of any reason. I just don't really do that. I don't tell people who to vote for. I just tell you, you should vote. But I do have heroes of the faith that some people associate with politics and movements, and you shouldn't. And one of those people is Martin Luther King. This is his weekend. If you have not read Letter from a Birmingham Jail, you have not read a brilliant piece of Christian doctrine. Every high school student before they graduate from high school should read this, period. Should do it. I'm stunned that people don't. Not because it's Christian-based. It is. It is a defense of being Christian when you are clearly being wronged. It's just hard to fathom. We think of the letters in the New Testament. The farther back you go in history and you hear of people suffering, it kind of loses something. You forget that those were human beings that were suffering. This is recent. Sitting in a jail, the letter is written to Christian pastors. It's written to Christian pastors who were criticizing him for peaceful protests. They were literally telling him to just shut up and take it. That's how it came across. This letter, rather than being angry and defensive and attacking, which would have been justified, is beautifully written from compassion and mercy for the people who are wronging him. It is a brilliant, written, moment-in-time piece of Christian literature. You should read it. You should read it. Letter from a Birmingham Jail. It shows somebody who's walking in love, in the light, when all things are pressing in, still refusing to let that light shine. when I was in the woods and my light went out, I forgot that I had a backup light. So I was literally stumbling in the darkness because I could not see until I remembered, oh yes, we all need that core doctrinal truth about us that keeps us pulled towards the light, as an analogy. I don't know how many have played the game where you take a flashlight, much like the way I'm holding this microphone, and you turn off the lights and you put the light on your face and you do like spooky stories. Would you raise your hand if you've done that? Okay, right? You know, and it looks funny because the shadows. Well, that's how light works. It illuminates shadows. And as one of my mentors said, if you're ever going to be Christian for real, you're going to choose to follow Jesus. You're going to have those heart examinations regularly. You're choosing to let the light of God's love not point up your nose, but to illuminate who God is. And as soon as you pass your hand in front of a flashlight that's pointed like that, the shadows of your hand will emerge. The deep recesses of what are not in God's view or what God wants to illuminate, and your immediate reaction is to pull it back, to be defensive, to be fearful. We all need to remember, this letter is written to refute a doctrinal truth that probably we don't argue about. We just don't argue much as Christians about who Jesus was. Our friends outside of the walls may debate that with us. Christians need to remember some of the hidden gems within these letters about loving one another radically. Radically. So I have two things for you today. One is I have something when you leave that is the policy manual in this church's one-page statement about working through differences. If you become an officer here from now on, an elder or a deacon, you will have this in your policy manual. And yes, it sounds prescripted. It is. Because when we're at our worst, we need something that goes beyond, just don't hate one another. We all know that. Yeah, but how do I do that? How do I do that when someone's gossiped about me? It's in there. And you should take it for your own life. It's just a one-page statement. This is what you do when you've been wronged. This is what you do when you've wronged somebody else. We need a starting point that's specific because this kind of behavior, not getting along with one another, this is Satan's playbook. This is Satan's number one job. Just break them up, just get them off their game, and they'll be walking around in the woods blind, and I'll be happy. I know I'm personifying Satan in a goofy way, but that's what something that's not of God does. It keeps us in the dark. And when we're not unified in love, that means you don't have to like everything about me. You don't have to like everything about the person next to you. But you've got to walk in love. And hatred within the church is a spiritual cancer. It must be exercised quickly. And this is a prescription for it. I'd love your feedback. If you don't like it, if you've got a better suggestion, we need more than just statements. Don't hate one another. What do you do when somebody's wronged you? There is another prescriptor when it's someone outside the faith, when somebody outside the family does this wrong, because they're not beholden to the same standards you have. It's not fair. You and I are held to a standard that God gives us. People outside these walls are not. Their understanding of justice, their understanding of fairness, their understanding of forgiveness, it's very different. Just look at our jail system. When you do something wrong, what happens? You spend time. Doesn't matter if you get better. It's just time. What do Christians do? We forgive each other and we work through the pain. We try and learn what God is teaching us. It's hard. It's hard work. If you're still with me, say, I'm still here. This idea of walking in the light and in the darkness by not operating in hate is powerful. And it's hard. It's hard. I said I have a second thing for you. When we close today, I'd like to offer just a moment. If you're in a place where you're dealing with pain from somebody else, I'm not going to ask you to stand up. I just want to prepare you for it. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. We're all going to bow our heads. We're not going to do a surprise call to the front for Jesus. It's just going to be an opportunity for you to pray for healing from somebody that's wronged you. And if you know you've wronged somebody else, for God to illuminate the steps you can take to make it right with them. Another little anecdotal thing. How do we show love to one another? How do we truly show love to one another in Christian community that's appropriate, that makes people feel good? I would always encourage everyone here to read The Five Love Languages if you never did. If my wife and I did not read that book, we would not be married. That's a fact. When my wife and I dated, we have two different love languages. It's a very practical thing. So just say one time real quick. If you're home, you can say it too. Hold up five fingers. Everybody hold up five fingers. Five love languages. One, two, three. Five love languages. Easy book to read. I give it to everyone I do premarital counseling for. It makes a lot of sense. But I want to talk about, in general, ways to show love within Christian community that everybody here can do. And it's the hardest for me. It is the hardest. When I feel great, I told you I feel good. When I feel great and I'm operating from my strengths, everybody has strengths. I don't stop moving. I have a lot of energy. I'm just always going. It's always the next project. I never stop. I always keep going. One of the things that we all need to do is stop and affirm people constantly. Specific instances to say, when you did this, I noticed it and I appreciate it. So I asked Paul if I could use permission. And I said a few weeks ago, we were gonna do a little Sunday school class on memorizing your mission statement. And I said it for a few weeks. We had a little class this morning, and the goal is over 3 weeks to actually be able to write down what your mission is on earth and then to memorize it. And I mentioned it to Paul, I'm gonna do the class, but I'm not gonna publicize it because of what's going on. I don't wanna have a big crowd in the room. So we had our class this morning, but Paul, when I mentioned it, said, I was thinking about that. Now, to you, it doesn't mean a lot. But what Paul is telling me is, when you were preaching on that, I was paying attention. When you were seeing that, and I've been thinking, and then he gave me what he's been thinking about his own mission on earth, articulating it with very specific responses. To you, it doesn't mean a lot. But to a pastor and a colleague, it means a lot. It's why when he preaches, I take notes. I'm showing him. I'm listening to what you're doing. I'm not asking you to do this for me. I'm asking you to do this for other people. Who are the people in your life today, and I mean this afternoon, that you could call and affirm? Love is a verb. To show them, of course you don't hate them, but to show them above and beyond, you know and appreciate them, you love them and affirm what they are, who they are, how God has created them uniquely. Who could you call with just a surprise phone call to say, you know, I've always loved when you... I've always loved about you, so-and-so. And I mean a friend, a surprise call and note to somebody to affirm them, to show them, you help me walk in love. You illuminate the love of God for me. Love in the New Testament is described as agape. It's not friendship. It's not romance. It's not buddies. It is godly love. And everyone here, every single person here right now, has been given the ability to walk in godly love. It makes the world brighter. My phone got me out of a jam. God's love brings people out of despair, horrible circumstances. You don't know who the person is that God puts on your heart to call and affirm or to reach out and have coffee with who is close to despair. Walk in love. Help them walk a clear path. When we do that, you will find that you stumble a lot less often. When you are this outpouring of love with no expectation in return, whether you're at home, whether you're here, I want to encourage you to walk without stumbling. And more importantly, help others walk without stumbling. When you're in despair, when you're hurting, what do you see? You see despair and hurting. I was in a pretty blue place. I don't get depressed very often. I was right on the cusp of it. When I was dealing with physical stuff, my whole being is, my identity is on, I can run, I can do these things. I know I'm getting older, but in my mind, I'm 18. It threatened my core. You don't know what it's like, what someone is dealing with like that, who needs a little bit of that love. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna pray for reconciliation for you from someone who's wronged you. I'm going to ask you to think in your own mind who you might need to reach out and ask forgiveness for. And I'm also going to ask that if you have a physical ailment, that you feel comfortable after worship coming up, I'll lay hands on you. We'll pray for one another. And that's a gift that we can give each other today. Amen? Holy Spirit, I pray that for every person here who has been wronged by somebody, small or large, that's still lingering, for someone who hasn't apologized to them or who has slighted them and moved on, but the wound still exists, I pray, Holy Spirit and Jesus, that you would heal that wound of anger, hurt, pain, and you would smooth over and instead fill it with agape, that they would turn around where there has been wrongs against them, each of my sisters and brothers here and those at home, and exude love in return for injustice. May we learn from the saints like Martin Luther King who have come before us. I pray for people who may not be aware that they've wronged somebody, that they would take the impetus and the conviction and the nudge from you to reach out to somebody and apologize, just to smooth things over and to let that person know it wasn't intended, or if it was, that you ask for forgiveness and repentance and moving ahead. And finally, Lord, this morning I ask for physical healing, that if there's anyone here who's dealing with the natural things that come with aging or with specific sicknesses, that you, Jesus, would help them walk in the light of confidence that comes from healing and a path to healing. Doctors and nurses, I pray for wisdom. And for those who are here who are sick, I pray for restoration and healing in the name of Jesus. Lord, thank you that we remember love is a verb, and you first walked into darkness and brought the light out so that we might know the truth about being in your family and what it means to walk in love. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, and all of God's people said, amen. Would you please stand and join me in affirming what we believe to be true in the words of the Apostles' Creed?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, let us continue our time of worship as we go before God with the prayers of the people. Let us pray. God, our refuge and strength, we ask that you shelter us from life's storms, from pandemic pain, from heartache, from loss. Strengthen us to withstand the worry, the exhausting but necessary work, the temptations to stray from your light and into the darkness. Hold us close like the mother hen who covers her chicks with her wing, so that we can know that we are yours, so that we can feel your steady presence and know your peace. God, you are in the midst of the city. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. Help us to know your presence among us. God, comfort us with the strength of your guidance in a world experiencing so much pain, so much upheaval. May our world's leaders walk humbly, practice faithful discernment, surrounding themselves with honest truth tellers who will hold them to your ethic of love and justice. Be with those around the world who are serving your church and serving our nation. Keep them safe. May they be a light to all they serve. God, help us to be still. Help us to forget about the work still left undone. Help us to rest here in your presence. Help us Help us to behold you. Help us to belong to you. We cannot continue without the rest you provide. Help us embrace this as a great gift. United as the body of Christ, we lift these prayers to you. Hear us now if we pray the prayer Christ taught us by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So great to gather here with you all this week. It's an exciting time in the life of our church. A lot is changing, but a lot is happening at the same time. And one of the things I want to call your attention to is the connection cards that you can see in the seats. One of the things we're specifically asking for help for this week is we need some volunteers for Children's Sunday School. Now, that being said, this is not the rest of your life every Sunday from 8 to noon. This is a few times a year to be able to help out our children, go in there and even just be present with our kids so that you can better know them, they can better know you, and you can be a part of bringing them up in the faith. If you've got an interest in helping out with Sunday school, again, not every Sunday for the rest of your life, but for a time, we could really use your help with that. So put that on the connection card, if you would. Friends, this is the time in our service where we give back to God some of what God has given us. And our gifts to God have helped us be able to spread the news about this great congregation, have helped us to be able to improve our church homes so that we're ready to welcome new folks in and to welcome others to come into God's light. So this time in our worship service, we celebrate with God's gifts and our morning offerings.
Bye.
Father, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the blessings upon blessings that you have given each one of us. We ask that you use these offerings to shine your light out into the world. These things we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you at home for being such a wonderful part and faithful part of our family, for giving, for participating. Thank you for being here. This is a wonderful church family. I continue to be amazed at all the things being thrown at us, and we keep gathering and we keep being the church. We never stopped, But I think this is a glorious time to be a part at San Pedro in the family. Next week, we're going to dedicate our sanctuary. It looks beautiful. We're going to do something called Kirkin o' the Tartan, which is bagpipes and a Scottish tradition, and we will dedicate our sanctuary. It's going to be fun. You can see it next week. It's closed now. We want to have a big reveal. Thank you again for being a part of our family. Keep loving. And I know if there's anything we learned today, it's when you're in the woods, carry a light. Amen?
And now, friends, may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Copy of that HR thing, sort of reconciliation on the way out if you want one. If you want to stay for healing prayer, I'll be in the front. Go in peace. Thank you for worshiping with us today.
Yeah.